Talk a little bit about what happened here yesterday. What little we know, the information I have is wholly preliminary. I wouldn't put, I have strong confidence in what I'm going to share with you, but it's not officially 100% fact yet. When I'm done, I'll let you ask me questions, and then I'm going to invite you to come with me over to the edge of the hill so you can take a few pictures, and then I'm going to shoot you back here across the street. So thank you for this. I have my little script here because I can't remember all the details, and whenever you're ready.
What do you know about what caused the crash?
Okay, my name is Brian Rayner. I'm a senior air safety investigator with the National Transportation Safety Board. Late yesterday afternoon, about 5:30 Eastern Daylight Time, a Bell 206 Lima 3 Plus, registration November 230 Alpha Echo, operated by Medevac Life Team. 135 medical evacuation flight. They were here to pick up a cardiac patient. When witnesses reported seeing the helicopter heading in approximately this direction strike a guy wire supporting the tower that you see behind me. Pieces were seen to separate from the helicopter, and the helicopter descended. Basically, the body, the fuselage of the helicopter fell basically vertically from that point to a point 200 yards behind me. Tragically, the airline transport rated pilot, a flight medic, and a flight nurse were fatally injured. Here today on scene to assist me are two members of the Federal Aviation Administration. Forgive me, I think it's the Louisville office. Representatives from the operator, their director of operations, their chief pilot, their director of maintenance. I have representatives from the airframe manufacturer, as well as the engine manufacturer, also here with me. And to put it in simple terms, our job is to look at, in this case, the man, the machine, and the environment. The pilot records are coming here to the scene. We know that at his date of hire, 6 years ago, he had 17,000 total hours of flight experience and multiple type ratings in both airplanes and helicopters. He's an extremely experienced airman. The machine, we're going to look at the maintenance record, we're going to look at the aircraft, where it is. The fuselage of the helicopter is here behind me, about 400 feet further behind me is where the main rotor mast, main rotor head, and all of one main rotor blade and a half, three quarters of another main rotor blade, all attached, were still found. The missing segment of the damaged main rotor blade, we have yet to discover, but we're looking for it. The cable that we suspect was struck by the helicopter is approximately an inch and a half in diameter. And the engineers who are experts in the construction and the care and the inspection of these towers noticed significant displacement of the mount point of these guy wires. I can't explain exactly what these signatures are, but they're prominent, they're fresh, and they've been documented. Drone survey of the cables has yet to identify any strike marks. It's it's quite possible that we won't discover them, but it's also quite possible that once they get the digits back to a computer in an office environment with, you know, less glare and everything else, they might be able to blow up the images and find some of the signatures that we're looking for. The environment, the weather was much like this. It was still daylight, so winds were insignificant, so we're not really worried about the meteorology. The path of the helicopter and the azimuth of the sun and its height above the horizon is something that we'll look at. The physical environment includes the tower, obviously, and the guy wires that support it. And we're just going to go through all these things. As a group, we're going to sort of move abreast. And then before we depart the area, we'll sit down and we'll share what each team, if you will, has developed. What we're doing here today is gathering facts. We're not trying to attach any meaning to them. Oftentimes when you work in an accident, what you find here at the scene doesn't become information until it's compared with something that you find in a computer offsite or a log book or a witness you hadn't spoken to before and that sort of thing. I want to thank the local sheriff's office as well as the state police. They're phenomenal in securing the scene, identifying witnesses. I'm going to be getting both written witness accounts as well as contact information for witnesses. There were people here at the restaurant that witnessed the event, people up and down the roadway here. There were quite a number of people at the landing zone with the patient anticipating the arrival of the helicopter, and all those people have been identified. So I'm confident that we're gonna have a great deal of information developed before we leave here. And I think that about covers it. And I'll entertain your questions for a minute or two.
Has this crew been in here before? Do you know whether they had flown in here?
It's my understanding that the pilot has used this landing zone before.
Multiple times,
The number of times, I don't know. I hope to learn that. It'll give us a little more fidelity about his understanding of the area and the hazards.
So is it possible he just simply, because of how small the wire was, just didn't see it?
You know, you're moving into a human factors realm that's actually a little further down the road. I mean, the fact is, it's a significant hazard. It's a known hazard. Exactly what risk management measures were employed prior to coming here, both in the past and for this particular flight, I don't know. But as we get to the narrow end of the funnel, I can assure you that if not me directly, one of our human factors specialists back at headquarters certainly will. We have a very skilled staff back at our headquarters.
How close is the landing zone? Was he on final approach to landing?
It's my understanding that he was, I guess, for lack of a better way to describe it, he was doing an orbiting reconnaissance while he was waiting for equipment and people to be in place in the LZ itself. I don't have the fine details of that. That was just sort of a one over the world view that was given to me before I came over here.
Where was exactly he was supposed to be?
Pardon me, one more time?
Was the football field the landing zone?
I don't know if it was in the athletic field, adjacent to. I haven't been over there yet. I still need to go over there after we're done talking.
We had heard from some folks that the pilot had an opportunity to land, but then decided against it and went back around. Is that essentially kind of what happened?
No, I can't comment on that. I have no idea. But I understand that his intentions were voiced over the radio, and among the people I'm going to talk to are people who heard the transmissions, and I'm certain that those, you know, the principals that were waiting for him in the LZ knew what his intentions were. I'm sure they were in communication, and I'm sure I'll get that.
How much of this can't you find right now? You said you guys were looking for part of this. How much is missing?
The outer portion of one main rotor blade. It's a two-bladed main rotor system. One blade is damaged but intact, and one blade shows, I don't know, I've only seen photographs, maybe half of its original length, three quarters, and the end is significantly damaged. So the outboard portion of that rotor blade would be nice to find.
Any idea what happened to the patient they were going to pick up?
I understand he's doing very well. You know, without going into details, which is probably in violation of some HIPAA regulation, I don't know this person, but anecdotally, I heard from one of the chiefs down there that he was doing well.
Where the sun was.
Wait a minute. Let me go over here, because some of you have had more than one turn.
In regard to the failure after it hit, I think when we all picture a helicopter crash, kind of picture it spinning down the road. So you're saying that the rotor assembly came apart from the main body, and the main body of the helicopter just kind of went straight down, and then the rotor assembly kind of came down separately.
Yes. They were separated while the helicopter was in flight, and they came to rest on the ground about 400 feet apart from one from the other.
And which cables are we talking about? The cables kind of pointing out this direction, or any idea? I mean, if you're doing a circular motion, it would make me think that it's that kind of the cables coming off to the left there that were the ones that were.
I'm a little challenged directionally from here, but the guy wires you see coming from near the top of the structure over here, and you see them passing through the middle of the roof of the restaurant here.
Okay.
But at what height above the ground, I don't know yet.
You had kind of mentioned where the sun was on the horizon. Is it possible the pilot could find it for a second?
Well, that's evaluation I'm not prepared to do, but the position of the helicopter, its ground track, its heading, and where the sun was above the horizon, and where it was magnetically, you know, oriented with the helicopter, we're gonna do those evaluations.
How unusual is it that a helicopter would hit wires and the wires wouldn't break? I would expect them to break, but is that normal?
I'm not an engineer, and I'm not qualified to define.
Have you ever seen that before in your experience?
Normal, but the cable, I'm told, is an inch and a half thick or better, helping to support that tower. And the helicopter main rotor blades are. An aluminum skin over a composite honeycomb.
Based on your experience, how long do you think you might be on the ground here? Are we talking days or weeks?
Days. We have a aircraft recovery company en route. They're going to help us recover the airplane, the helicopter, and then concurrent with the removal and recovery of the helicopter, we'll be doing examinations of the wreckage, because it's on a hillside, there's significant fire damage, and so we're going to sort of look as we go.
Have you ever worked a case quite like this?
Yes and no. I mean, I've been doing this for a long time. We try our best to approach each one individually. And again, as I said before, we're just gathering facts. We're not trying to attach meaning to what we gather. A lot of what I need is in a computer somewhere, it's in an aircraft logbook or a computer that tracks the maintenance and the service life of time-limited components on the aircraft, that sort of thing. The pilot's records are all archived. The operator's been extremely cooperative. And so I'm confident that, when this is all done, that I'll have enough information, facts, specialist reports if I need them, for the board to support a probable cause. But I don't do probable cause. That's outside my purview.
How long will it take till we have that?
We aim to complete these investigations. Me personally, I aim for a year. I'm not meeting that mark just yet. We've had a couple of, pretty trying years. And then there's a lengthy quality control process after I'm done, after I submit it. Quality control is done, editing is done, analysis of what I'm presenting is done. There's a whole cast of experts above me that go through everything that I've done and everything that my team has done, everything that we're presenting, before they present it to the board for those five members to make a determination of probable cause. So it's very complex, and there are a lot of people involved above me, a great deal smarter than I am, who really look at this stuff at the microscopic level.
So before we
know? Oh, it'll probably be, if I do my best, if I meet my mark, 18 months.
How long do you think before they remove the helicopter?
We're going to start on that tomorrow.
In regard to the final moments in the copter, I guess what all information will there be that you can recover? Is there a flight data recorder? Is there a black box that records communications in there? What type of things can you recover?
No, this aircraft operating under these rules is not required to have a flight data recorder or a cockpit voice recorder. Over the years that I've been doing this job, the avionics that people could put in their airplanes, their helicopters, whatever, have become so sophisticated and at lower cost, such that a lot of these devices, and your small Cessnas, Pipers, whatever, they capture a remarkable amount of data. Now, these devices aren't hardened, but frequently we can recover these devices, or just the chips inside, and the magicians that work in our labs down in Washington, or north of here in Washington, can recover some remarkable data. But I don't think that's going to be the case here. Just a quick overview with one of the company principals about what was installed in the helicopter. No, we're not going to get that kind of fidelity.
Any radio communication that you're aware of right now, or is that going to be a turn?
Well, again, I've cast the net, and I'm sure that the state police are going to provide me with people who were on the ground and communicating with the crew.
Is there a standard operation, or is it just line of sight when you're circling something like a tower like this?
There are many layers to that. I'd rather not answer that right now. One more, and then we're going to take a walk.
How long will you get the helicopter out of there, and what kind of challenge is that going to be?
Well, we're going to start tomorrow. And as we recover the helicopter, and as certain things are unearthed, revealed, whatever, we may have to stop and do a little more careful examination. We may have to stop and harvest a particular component that raises an eyebrow, if you will. So I can't predict, but I anticipate that it'll be out of here tomorrow. The people who are coming are very good. This is what they do. And if they don't have the equipment they need when they arrive, they'll rent it. They have a vast network. It's amazing what they can accomplish. They're very efficient. They're experts at both recovery and preservation of wreckage, preservation of evidence. They're very good.